Welcome back to Blue Hens Beat. I'm Nihja White, junior wide receiver, and we are doing a new segment for Black History Month. And I'm sitting here with Mr. Lenny Williams, and we are going to talk about football from the past and football in the present. Start off with just football. And how was it like to play back in 1952?
You didn't have platoons, so you didn't have an offense and a defense. You played both ways. So I was a center on offense and a linebacker on defense. And, you know, you guys got it easier as now you can play, you know, both ways if you like.
Just a little bit, have to focus on one position.
Right.
Sometimes, too, your special teams and your offensive, defensive position. But, I mean, in high school, we went both ways.
Yeah.
Well, that must have been hard to do it in college.
On occasion, we would have guys who would come in just to play defense or guys who would just play offense, but most of the 11 guys on either team would be going both ways.
You have leather helmets back then?
Yeah, the same type of helmet you guys are wearing now, the old Michigan helmet.
Just painted on?
Yeah.
Just painted on the leather. No face mask?
No face mask.
No mouthpieces?
No mouthpieces.
So it's basically rugby with football rules.
He just played it tough. Yeah. If you had a broken nose or something, they put something on. But until you got hurt, it was straight up, you know, the old style.
I've seen that the guys were traditionally smaller, or
Oh yeah, I would be a small lineman. Small. Now. I mean, I think at my maximum weight at that time was about 210, and the average center even here is what, 250.
That's average. So yeah, and centers are usually the smaller guys on the
right.
On the line. Yeah, I'm about 210, trying to play next season at 215, mm-hmm. And you have receivers like Andre Johnson who are 220,
oh, yeah.
Marcus Colston who's 230. Mm-hmm. That's a pretty big difference. So what was it like being the first African American to play for the University of Delaware?
Well, you know, surprisingly, it was probably some of the best years of my life, to be very honest with you. Interesting enough, at that time, I had not played on a team or been in a situation or education where I was in an all-white environment, and almost everybody else on the team had not been exposed to any black athletes because they were coming out of all-white scenarios. So for many people, we were kind of new, you know. And interesting enough, going back, I was 17 years old when I came on, and some of my best friends today are guys that I met 60 years ago here at the university. I think you heard of Bob Hooper, who was a quarterback, and we're still friends, you know. So you meet people in college, and in some situations you know them the rest of your life. And that's happened to me. And it became almost like a brotherhood because the guys were very protective of me. They didn't want me to be embarrassed because what you're experiencing is an integrated society here in Newark. And when I came here, this whole town was segregated. All the restaurants would not serve black folks. The movie was segregated. The whole town was segregated. Black folks lived over on New London Avenue, and white folks lived everywhere else. The dorms weren't even integrated. I may have been the first black person to live in Sharp Hall at that time. I mean, it was a tough time, but it wasn't a negative experience for me. I think most of all it was a positive experience for me, and it was a positive experience for many of the other guys who for the first time were exposed to a black athlete or a black guy who, and I wasn't just a jock, I mean I was a pretty good student, and that makes a difference.
Was it uncharacteristic for you to keep those friendships at that time? Because people think 1952 was a long time ago, but it's not that much.
In my scenario, I was the only black guy on the team, the only black person involved. And the guys were very sensitive that I not suffer any embarrassment or discrimination. And if, for instance, if we went to a restaurant And if I couldn't get served in that restaurant, they didn't want to get served. And many times when we would be, after we'd win a game, and the guys want to go out somewhere and get a couple of beers, I didn't do any beer drinking, but if we went into a bar, and at that time, they were segregated bars, and in this area around Newark, it was difficult to find a place that would serve a black student. Well, the guys would go crazy and threaten to just completely dismantle some of these places, you know. So some of those experiences were, my real concern was these guys were going to get themselves in trouble because they were so offended that their guy, I mean, and I was their guy, wasn't going to be treated properly. So that's a unique experience to have that feeling. Mm-hmm. And then today, after the homecoming game, my wife and I met with Hooper and his wife, Andy Wagner and his wife, Vince Grandy and his wife, and we had dinner together, and we've met before and done things together. But this is unique in the sense that it's a 60-year relationship. Right. Right. You know, I mean, it goes back when we were 17, 18 years old. Right. And when you add that on today, it's unique. Who do you know that you would have known 60 years? As things developed gradually and integration became more the rule of the land at during those years, more black students came into the university, more black athletes. And when I sit up in the stands now and look out there, you guys are the majority.
Right.
You know, and anybody who stood up in the stands and looked down when I was playing, I was the only one out there. Kind of interesting because a lot of my personal friends, guys I went to high school with, had all gone to black colleges. And when they would come home, their experiences were different than ours.
Completely different.
For instance, there were no frats. I know the campus are here and some campus are near, but when I came, that was non-existent, but all my friends were away at colleges where they were involved and so forth. And I would get all the songs and the handshakes and all that kind of stuff. And now, of course, there's a chapter on campus and so forth.
Delaware is one of the last states to desegregate, I think it was, wasn't it?
Not only was it the last state, it was the first state in which a court order was issued ordering them to desegregate. A court ruled separate but equal could not apply because Delaware State, which was the other college that was a segregated black school, didn't have the facilities or the curriculum.
Right.
And so forth, so it couldn't be separate but equal. And out of that case, Parker versus University of Delaware, 10 students who were students at Delaware State College came into the University of Delaware. And then 3 or 4 years later, I was one of the minority students to come into the University of Delaware. And the lawyer who filed that case is a lawyer who, when I finished law school, I went to work with. So it was a kind of a real amazing kind of dynamic in terms of how that all occurred, you know. And then while I was here, 1954, the Brown versus the Board decision comes down, and all educational facilities in the United States became desegregated. Not in practice necessarily, but the law became separate but equal was no longer the law, and things have changed dramatically from that decision, which may be probably the most important decision in our lifetime.
Was the training the same back then? I mean, we're here all year. I think we get about 4 weeks off during the whole year.
Is that right?
I think so. During the calendar year, the school year, I think we get about 4 or 5 weeks off total.
You left in June, and you came back in maybe a week before school started in September.
Man.
And, you know, I worked construction every summer, and I could walk up a bit and would come back, because I was kind of small to be a lineman.
Right.
And I wanted to get some weight on, so I would work construction, doing brick work and stuff like that. And of course, when I'd come back, I would have picked up, each year I picked up maybe 10, 15 pounds. You know, when I finished high school, I weighed 175. After my first year, I was up to about 190. And then the second year, I was at 200. And by the time I graduated, it was about 210, 215. The other thing, too, is the scholarship help you got would make it difficult to be able to stay at the school for 11 months because, I mean, the amounts that you guys and all the benefits you get today compared to what we got is, let me give you an example. Tuition at the University of Delaware, when I was here for a semester, was $142 for a Delaware student. Now compare that to what it is today, and I don't know what it is today, but
$142. Get you a polo t-shirt.
Exactly. Everybody worked during the summer, and you got letters over the summer, and coaches asking how you're doing and suggesting you do certain things. And about, say, 10 days before school started, we all came back and jumped into practice and trying to get in shape, you know. So it's a different, you guys got a different world going with you now, you know.
Our world is football. Yeah. It is football. But, I mean, it's not like nobody complains about it. It's what everyone does, and you want to get to the next level, it's what you have to do.
Now, one of the interesting things, though, is that a good number of the guys who were on the team with me went on to graduate school. The guys we're mentioning, for instance, Bob Hooper is a dentist. We had a couple of guys who got PhDs in engineering who were on the same team. A lot of us were Dean's List students. A lot less recruiting, and guys came to play football because they wanted to play football. The university has already been assessed and evaluated as to diversity. And here it is 60 years since I was here as a student, and they're saying that it's not diverse enough. I mean, it's lagging. So I just got a letter from the president. They're trying to put together some folks to begin to try to have more black students, right, more black faculty members, and to further integrate the school. You know, it's almost embarrassing to think that here we are 60 years later, and they're saying that the school doesn't have enough black folks here.
Right.
And then when I look out on the football field, 80% of the guys out there are black.
How proud are you of the school and the program, the football program, or just the school in general, and how everything has evolved?
I think the thing that you take from an experience like I had here is that these are lifelong friendships that are unique for me as well as for the other person, because many of them would not be that involved or that close to a minority person. So that they can look back in their lifetime and say, hey, you know, I've been friendly with this guy for 50, 60 years. You know, and race has never been an issue in that sequence. You all have the same. I mean, there are guys on the team that I'm sure 50 years ago you'll be in my position, sitting around with some guys who you went to law school with.
There'll definitely be some guys.
And that's going to happen. I mean, and that's the great thing. And it helps both sides. You know, the exposure that you get and the exposure that they get in being involved and so forth is unique. And that's why this whole process of being involved and interrelating and so forth is so very important.
Thank you again for your time, Mr. Lenny Williams.